radios for just $1.99. That's 1-800-340-3700.
The following is a special presentation on TNN, the Nashville Network.
He was the best friend a song ever had. A rock and roll phenomena who became a country music legend. The life and times of Conway Twitty, next on TNN.
Conway Twitty can rightfully claim to be the most successful entertainer of all time. No one in the history of popular music has had more number one hits. No one. Not Elvis, not the Beatles, not Michael Jackson. But to just look at the statistics of the man called the Heartland Heartthrob does a great disservice to Conway. His phenomenal record sales do not explain the man, his music, or his enormous mass appeal.
Hello, darling. Nice to see you. It's been a long time. You're just as lovely as you used to be.
Conway just showed the people he could do anything he wanted to. He could sing country, he could sing rock. Maybe he can sing opera, I mean, if you don't want him to.
And just to know it means so much to me.
Well, everybody has to have their own little identity, and I think Conway's, he had that. It gave him a certain little magic, and he knew how to sell a song in a very great way. And this got better as time went on.
What I'm trying to say is I love you, and I miss you. I'm so sorry that I did you wrong?
Conway was the consummate country entertainer. I remember seeing him on television years ago before I ever came to Nashville and thinking, this guy has got it all. He's got the looks, he's got the voice, he's got the moves, he's got the whole thing.
And if you should ever find it in your heart to forgive me. Come back, darling.
Conway Twitty's career was truly remarkable. Born of humble origins, this son of the South rose to the top of the entertainment world and managed to stay on top through five decades.
I can't think of many entertainers in the world that have ever done that before. And I remember I asked him about it one time. And he was going through one of his periodic style shifts. He did that all through his career. And I said to him what an interesting thing it was. It was like a snake shedding its skin and becoming a new body every time. And he said, the only thing in life that's constant is change. You change or you die. So you had this guy who was a rockabilly star, who was a teen idol, who made the shift into honky-tonk music, then adopted a blue-eyed soul thing, then became like a gruff-voiced gospel shouter. I mean, he did all of that stuff really, really well, as only somebody from the Deep South can really do it.
A large part of Conway's longevity can be attributed to his uncanny ability to time after time reinvent his sound. But this gift, the capacity to change, may have in some measure been an accident of birth. The man who would one day be known as Conway Twitty was born Harold Lloyd Jenkins in Friars Point, Mississippi on September 1st, 1933. He was the first of three children of Floyd and Velma Jenkins. Like most of the people who lived along this impoverished Mississippi levee, the Jenkins were poor, and the Great Depression had only made things worse.
They had a good life, but it was hard. It was really tough. They told stories about, for Christmas, they would get something like a chocolate pie, and that was a big deal to them because they were so poor, and they really had to make money stretch and count, you know, it had to go for necessities rather than luxury items.
But for young Harold, the appreciation of music, all kinds of music, was probably the greatest gift he ever received. It was almost as natural to him as breathing.
Conway's dad was a riverboat pilot, and a lot of that river music is levee, blues, and in some cases, showboats coming up. And still in those days, it was kind of the dying era of the showboat. So he would have heard Dixieland and the blues growing up.
His grandmother cooked for a man that he referred to as Paul Fuller. And they lived at his boarding house. And Paul Fuller gave him his first guitar when he was just 4 years old.
The only music I heard back then was country music. And that was on Saturday night. Everybody got together at my grandmother's house, and we listened to the Grand Ole Opry. I didn't know that there was another radio station in the world.
Conway attributed part of his love for music to Paul Fuller. He said Paul Fuller realized how much the Grand Ole Opry touched him and told him, one day, if you don't sing too high and ruin your vocal cords, then you'll be able to sing on the Grand Ole Opry.
The family lived within close proximity to both a white Pentecostal church and a black holiness church. That music has so much soul in it, and Conway would sit outside the black church and listen to the music coming out of there.
So he had the Grand Ole Opry, he had the blues, and he had the gospel music as a foundation.
When Harold was 10, the Jenkins family moved from Friars Point to Helena, Arkansas. The young boy grieved for the life he left behind in the Delta, but music helped to ease his pain and make his new life fuller. By the time he was 10 years old, Harold Jenkins had written his first song, and by age 12, Harold had formed his own band. They were known as the Phillips County Ramblers.
I say that I don't worry, and our parting brought no pain. I say that I'd be happy if we never meet again.
The group performed on KFFA, a local radio station in Helena, Arkansas. This recording was made in the station studio in 1946.
When music is like that for you, it's something that you don't just choose, it's something you have to do in a way. It's just kind of bubbles outside of you.
As a youngster, Harold was shy, but popular. While in his teens, he had begun preaching, but became disillusioned and gave it up. And while he loved music, back then, Harold believed his true calling was athletics, particularly baseball. While practicing one day, Harold met another young man who would become his lifelong friend, Hugh Carden. And as Hugh recalls, being Harold's teenage buddy was a distinct advantage.
We would work a deal to where I'd get my car, and he could get the date changed, but he'd make a deal to get the date for me with his girlfriend's girlfriend. So therefore, I would have a date, and he would have a date. And most of the time, we went on the levee there by the Mississippi River and get out and get sit down and play, start playing the guitar. And I'd sit over there and be trying to make out, you know. I said, that Harold Jenkins, he's kind of crazy. He got a problem in him playing that guitar. He ought to be flirting with his girl. Well, needless to say, I should have been playing the guitar myself, too.
In high school, Harold had a steady girlfriend. When it ended, he was brokenhearted. Soon after, he met another young lady named Ellen. He married Ellen when they discovered she was pregnant.
He lived with Mamma and Papa, my grandparents, and so did she after they got married and I came along. They loved each other, but the main thing, they were just awful young to be married and have a child.
Within a year, the couple agreed the marriage was a mistake and divorced. Harold's mother and father raised Michael. Harold headed back to Chicago, where he had gotten a job after graduating from high school. Having been scouted by the Philadelphia Phillies, he hoped this situation was only temporary and he would soon be playing professional baseball. But his life was about to change dramatically.
The Life and Times of Conway Twitty returns in a moment on TNN.
Brought to you by Excedrin. Excedrin, the headache medicine. Tylenol was always around. So I always used it. I mean, you know, for all the things that you use Tylenol for. But my mother said she's always giving out medical advice. She said to relieve headaches, you should take Excedrin. It's better than Tylenol. She was right. Major bonding experience with Mom. Plus, I got something that's better for headaches. I mean, what more could you want out of life?
Excedrin, the headache medicine.
I could rock. I was strong as I could be. I could rock. Nothing ever got to me.
After the kind of day you put in, all you want to do is fall into a nice, comfortable, easy chair in a quiet place.
Like a rock.
Of course, sooner or later, you'll have to go home.
Like a rock.
It happens in the hospital. It happens at home. It's the onset of heartburn. It's an attack of acid indigestion. For these stomach flare-ups, the number one choice of hospitals is Maalox. Hospitals know that nothing works faster to rush heartburn relief. Now you know it too. Fast-acting Maalox. Hospitals can count on it for speed, and that's just what you need. Maalox, the first choice for hospitals, the fast choice for home. In fast-acting Maalox tablets too.
Frankly, it makes me nervous.
It's not exactly what I call good news.
Hey, good for you.
Bad.
Very bad for plumbers like me.
The problem is, professional strength liquid plumber works too good.
This liquid drain opener won't dilute in standing water. Stuff cuts right to the problem.
For hair clogs, nothing's faster, except me.
I hate it.
Professional strength liquid plumber drain opener. Sorry, plumbers.
Soap cleans, but dries. New Vaseline Intensive Care Moisturizing Body Wash cleans and moisturizes for touchably soft skin. Now that's a positive clean. New Vaseline Intensive Care Moisturizing Body Wash.
How important is freshness in a dry cat food?
Cat Chow has this freshness seal to guarantee it's consistently fresh when you buy it and serve it. Purina Cat Chow brand. Better care makes better cats.
The Life and Times of Conway Twitty continues on TNN.
While Harold Jenkins may have dreamed of summer days on the baseball field, the United States Army had other ideas. In March of 1954, Harold became a soldier. He spent 2 years stationed in Yokohama, Japan, and once again, Harold turned to music.
He formed a band called the Cimarrons, and they entered the Army Talent Show. And had they won, they would have won an appearance on the Ed Sullivan Show. They came in second, so they didn't.
But the band continued playing throughout Japan. On March 14, 1956, Harold was discharged from the service. Upon returning home, he was immediately overwhelmed by the record industry's newest sensation, Elvis Presley.
As soon as I heard the first Elvis Presley record, it really, really stirred me up, because it was a mixture of gospel, blues, and country, is what it was. And that was exactly what I grew up singing.
He was a tremendous influence on Conway because it made him change careers. He threw down the baseball bat and glove and picked up a guitar, and the rest is history, as he'd say.
Well, come on, baby, we'll come on down to the rockin' and shoe joint in this town, rock house.
In 1956, Harold arrived in Memphis and was signed on Sun Records, Elvis's label. But not having established his own style and overshadowed by the King, he was soon dropped by Sun. Harold then moved to Mercury Records, but after a few recordings, he again was dropped.
I learned a good lesson from that experience with Mercury, and I really realized the importance of the song. I think that really began to come to the front of my mind at that point in my life, stronger than anything else, the song. And it didn't take it long to become the most important thing.
Soon after, Harold was offered a contract with MGM Records, but first, he decided he needed to make a dramatic change.
He felt like Harold Jenkins was not an eye catcher. He felt like that disc jockeys were getting records at this point in time from many, many people every day. So that's why he decided to change it. And he got a map down and came up with Conway and Twitty from a map, a road map. Conway, Arkansas, and Twitty, Texas.
I remember a lot of people, a lot of my friends in school laughing, you know, and pointing and snickering, saying, Conway Twitty's kid, Conway Twitty's kid. And, but it wasn't too long after that they didn't snicker so much.
Not long after he changed his name and signed his new deal with MGM Records in Nashville, Conway Twitty's career skyrocketed.
They went in the studio and cut some stuff. It's Only Make-Believe being one of them. Another song called I'll Try. And they decided that I'll Try was an up-tempo record, and that was what they were going to release. With much to Conway's dismay, he knew the hit was It's Only Make-Believe. I'll Try came out. It's Only Make-Believe was the B-side.
The record floundered. Conway quit the business in despair. But Conway's sense about It's Only Make-Believe soon proved to be correct.
I get this phone call one day, and it was from a disc jockey in Columbus, Ohio. He tells me that I've got the biggest hit that they've ever had in Columbus, Ohio. And I couldn't believe what he was saying. He was telling me how big this record was, how big Conway Twitty was going to be, and all this and that and the other. I couldn't believe it.
Conway and his drummer, Jack Nance, had written the song in 20 minutes. Now, after years of struggle, Conway Twitty was an overnight sensation. Even the king himself paid homage to Conway when the two men met.
When he walked in the room, Elvis started singing It's Only Make-Believe. It was supposedly one of Elvis's favorite songs. And, you know, a lot of people thought it was Elvis doing that song. It was Elvis recording under another name.
Everything came together. Conway Twitty was a genuine teen idol. It's Only Make-Believe was a number one hit and eventually sold over 8 million copies. Like Elvis, Conway parlayed his success into film roles. Conway was so popular, he was the role model for the 1960 Broadway show Bye Bye Birdie, which was later made into a movie. The show parodied his unique style and unquestioned success. But Conway was not truly happy.
It's almost, looking back, it's almost like a dream. It was like it was another thing, you know? It happened to somebody else and not me. And I was gone like 4 and 5 months at a time. And then I'd come home for a week or two, and I'd go out for another 4 or 5 months. That's the way it was. I wasn't home when most of my kids were born.
It was mostly just one night, night after night, going into the club and playing. I mean, caught up in the rock and roll feel. He didn't have much time to himself, or to his family, or anybody else, because he was his manager and people kept him going all the time.
But there was an even bigger problem. Conway was not being true to himself. He was a rock and roll star with a country music heart.
When Conway had a rock and roll career going, people who'd seen his show told me that right in the middle of this rock and roll show, he'd slip in 2 or 3 country songs. And I understand a couple of them were mine, songs like Heartaches by the Number. He'd rock them up pretty good, but he loved country music so much.
And record companies and his manager had always promised him, okay, well, we'll establish you in the rock field, and then we'll do some country stuff. And you can quit playing the rock scene, the rock venues. You can start doing some country music things.
Despite management promises, in the summer of 1965, while performing in Summers Point, New Jersey, a new stack of contracts arrived for Conway to sign. They called for him to play all the same old rock venues.
playing these clubs night after night after night after night, they're taking this toll on him. So he made up his mind one night in the middle of a song and put the guitar down and said, boys, that's it, I'm going home. And he went home.
The next month he was working country music clubs and earning just a little bit of money, no recording contract, but doing something he loved and wanted to do.
The life and times of Conway Twitty returns in a moment here on TNN.
Now, a brief on the Olympic Games from Haines.
At the first games, courageous athletes competed without clothes. Think how tough that was for announcers.
And a tall guy is passing the man with the mole. Or is that a freckle? Wait, here comes a bald guy on the outside.
If they had Haines back then, all those great styles and colors would have made it easier to tell them apart.
I see the Spartans are sporting black boxer briefs, and the Phoenicians are once again in purple.
I'm Michael Jordan, and you've been briefed.
I love Christmas time. The trees and lights, warm smiles, the music. Now you can bring that feeling home with a Citco Country Christmas cassette. Country stars like Alan Jackson, Lori Morgan, Alabama, and Randy Travis. 10 Christmas classics by 10 great country artists for only $2.49 with an 8-gallon fill-up. It's a Citco Country Christmas. You can feel it in the air. Happy holidays from Citco.
Nobody does it like you.
The new Hoover Steam Vac Deluxe with 5-brush agitator. Compared to professionals, there's no comparison.
Nobody does it like you.
Heinz calls their turkey gravy home style. But who makes gravy at home starting with water and cornstarch? Pepperidge Farm starts with natural stocks, flour, and turkey meat. It's made like homemade to taste like homemade.
Reminiscent of the spirit-filled all-night singings of long ago, some of the biggest names in gospel music meet at the Tabernacle to lift their voices and song.
Somehow just out of the blue.
Led by master tunesmith Bill Gaither.
You're still my friend.
It's a Ryman Gospel Reunion. Saturday, 10 Eastern on TNN.
He has no butt.
Getting mighty personal, aren't you, Ralph?
Was Narvel shocked?
Yeah.
We're shocked, too. Shocked at the great clips direct from the cutting room floor, never before seen on TV.
And the next thing I know, I'm running naked through Tom Jones' yard.
Called from exclusive Ralph Emery interviews with your country favorites.
I just can't believe I'm the daughter of Brooks and Dunn.
Take a good look back at Ralph Emery on the Record, Wednesday on TNN.
The life and times of Conway Twitty continues on TNN.
Many may have questioned his sanity when Conway gave up rock and roll. But Conway knew that he would only be truly successful if he followed his heart and his soul. And that heart and soul was pure and simply country.
I believe Conway would be the first one to make that transition from, you want to call it rock and roll, to country. But Conway did sing, he's singing pretty... He had a pretty good country twang, you know, I mean, which came out pretty naturally.
The prolific country songwriter Harlan Howard was instrumental in helping Conway to make a successful transition into country music. Harlan was a fan of the singer. The pair immediately hit it off when the two met in 1960. One time while in Nashville, the two men got together after a show. Conway played Harlan a couple of country songs Conway had written.
He sang them so well, you know. I said, Conway, have you ever really given any consideration to just really cutting a country record? And he said, oh, God, he said, that's what I started out to want to do. He said, in my childhood, it's all I wanted to be was like Hank Williams or somebody.
Encouraged and assisted by Harlan, Conway used his own money and recorded his country songs at the Muscle Shoals studio in 1965.
I told him that I knew somebody that might be interested. I was thinking of Owen Bradley at Decca Records. He was a dear friend of mine and a very smart man.
Owen said, I like the songs. Who's singing?
And he said, well, you wouldn't believe it if I told you. And he said, well, try me. And he said, well, he's a rock singer. No one said, no, that ain't no rock singer. That's a country singer.
We worked out the arrangements, and he came in, and we had a little session and got acquainted musically.
To be in a studio with him doing straight country songs with straight country pickers was a real one of the highlights of my life.
Our first ones were not successful. What I would do in those days, because the companies were much more they were much more patient than they are today. I mean, they gave you time to develop. We didn't really know what direction to go.
There was also another problem.
I think the industry was prepared to let him try it, to let him try to be who he wanted to be. The problem came when those records went out to country music radio stations, and the radio programmers went, oh, another one of these rock guys who wants to go country, you know, kind of thing. And he had a very, very difficult time convincing those radio people of his sincerity, of the sincerity of his intent as a country star.
We tried a little bit of that. And a little bit of this, for a little bit of that, till we finally latched onto a good song, which launched him into orbit, which was Hello, Darling.
Hello, Conway.
Hello, darling. Nice to see you. It's been a long time. You're just as lovely as you used to be.
It was such a shock to everyone. It's such a simple song, but yet has so much meaning to it. He recorded that song as an afterthought because it had some time left, just to throw it in. And he always brought his tapes back after every session and let everybody listen to it. And when I put it on and listened to it, I just broke out in a cold sweat. I mean, that was it. There were two or three people there with me at the time. And every one of them said, hey, man, that's beautiful. It was right.
What I'm trying to say is I love you and I miss you. And I'm so sorry that I did you wrong.
During the time I worked with him, I think he had 25 or 26 number one records. He developed into an excellent person to write his songs and work with his songs. I think he also found out who he was, you know. You don't just find out from one song. You sort of find out over a period of songs and several songs. And he had the opportunity to do that with our company, which was very patient and worked out good for everybody.
Conway referred to Owen as he was like a father to him, and Owen allowed him the room to experiment and to grow and to try things in the studio that maybe another producer wouldn't have. And Conway attributes knowing that the song is the most important thing from Owen Bradley. Owen Bradley taught him that very important lesson that he would say would be the key to his success all those years. The song is the most important thing.
Hello, Darling was one of many number one country hits for Conway Twitty. This 1970s classic became his signature song and lifelong concert opener.
And if you should ever find in your heart to forgive me, come back, darling.
By the mid-70s, Conway had firmly established himself as a force to be reckoned with in the country music business.
I was determined to make it in country music. It took me 10 years to work my way up and out of rock and roll music, up to country music. And once I got my feet on the ground, and you know this from dealing with me down through the years, that I was determined to make it in country music. But certainly, a chance to do duets with Loretta Lynn didn't hurt my career any at all.
Loretta Lynn chose him as her duet partner, insisted on him as her duet partner. I think that was a big thing. I remember at the time thinking, you know, That was like a seal of approval. I mean, she was a superstar in country, and there was no denying her country intent ever. It's like, I think that was a big endorsement.
The Life and Times of Conway Twitty returns in a moment on TNN.
It's the greatest thing that's happened to a sandwich since sliced bread. The one and only Vlasic Sandwich Stackers. Ham up your ham.
Wow.
Make your turkey pikey.
Whoa!
Pep it up with the original Sandwich Stackers from Vlasic and try new hearty garlic.
There's a smile in every Hershey bar.
Friday night, those rowdy sons of the Lone Star State return to pay tribute to the real sports stars. Hosted by Colin Ray and featuring the Pirates of the Mississippi. Plus, T. Graham Brown, the Dallas Cowboys celebrate Special Olympics. Then, the accolades continue as country's new generation of stars salute their Hall of Fame idols. Willie Nelson heads an all-star evening of country greats for a double celebration Friday on TNN.
Let freedom ring.
Garth Brooks joins Martina McBride, Full Speed Ahead, TNN, November 30th.
Here's looking at you, Ralph.
And you never look better. The Ralph Emery Show, weekday mornings, 9 Eastern, 8 Central on TNN.
I can't stop loving you.
Heartland Music presents the Statler Brothers.
Since you've gone.
The Statlers sing 24 classics in their brand new collection.
One girl, one boy.
24 great songs.
Some joy, memories are made of this.
Good night, sweetheart.
It's the Statlers' new collection.
Dear, have I told.
But it's not in stores. So order now.
He's got the whole world. In his hands.
Call 1-800-532-8585. To save COD charges, use your credit card or send check or money order for $14.98 for cassettes or $19.98 for CDs, plus $3.50 shipping to New Statler Brothers, P.O. Box 94155, Oklahoma City, Oklahoma.
The Life and Times of Conway Twitty continues on TNN.
Mississippi River can't keep us apart.
There's too much love in this Mississippi heart.
Too much love in this Louisiana heart.
Loretta Lynn was first introduced to Conway by Owen Bradley at a Nashville recording studio in 1968. She was one of his early rock and roll fans.
Owen was standing there talking to this woman, and he said, you've been telling me you want to meet Conway Twitty. She said, yeah, I want to meet old Conway. He said, you know I do. One of these days, you're going to have to fix that up.
And I looked up, and out come walking Conway. And I just stood there and looked at him, and I know he thought I was crazy. But he said, I hear you have one of my posters or something like that. And I said, yes. No paper on the wall, but I've got you up there. And he kind of laughed. And from that day on, well, we just, it was just like we never had been not together, you know.
Shortly after he made the transition to country music, Conway and Loretta were performing separately, but on the same bill in London.
We were back in the dressing room, and Conway had his guitar out, and he was strumming and singing. Of course, naturally, I strut through and sang harmony with him. And then I start singing, and he sings harmony with me. And we just decided, we looked at each other and said, And Conway always did this. If he liked a song or whatever he liked, he'd go, You know, he'd raise his eyebrows and go, You know. So we took a notion to record together. And we went back home and talked to Owen Bradley, and he said, I think it'd be great.
It didn't hurt either one of them. It worked out good. They made a good team. We had four or five number one duets, which is really... pretty good string.
Mississippi man, I'm a loser, but my God.
on the jump in the river, and here I go to bad Allegheny, you swim too slow.
The pairing garnered Loretta and Conway the Country Music Association Duo of the Year Award, 4 years running, from 1972 to 1975.
Too much love in this Mississippi heart.
Too much love.
His career was flying high. But Conway's drive and ambition left him little time for a social life. Following his brief teenage marriage, Conway had wed Mickey Jaco in 1956. They had three children. And though he was often on the road, his children thought Conway was a great dad.
There aren't any sons out there that could feel any more love from their father than I felt from mine. And I know that Joan and Kath and Jimmy felt from him, because even though he was gone a lot, and he was, we didn't get to see him very much, you know, but that we realized that was his job. That's what he did. And the time that we did spend with him and around him was quality time. He made sure of that, you know.
But the long separations were hard on Mickey and Conway.
I think the relationship got strained very early on. Even though they stayed together, it was strained, because of him being gone so much.
In 1972, the pair divorced. They then remarried in 1974 and stayed together for another 14 years before splitting up for good. During the 70s and 80s, Conway had many business ventures outside the music industry. A talent booking agency, a mobile home company, a string of convenience stores. He even had his own restaurant called Twitty Burger, and a AAA baseball team, the Nashville Sounds.
The coolest thing Conway did, I'm a big baseball fan, so the Nashville Sounds was the coolest thing to me. But most of the business ventures that weren't musical didn't work out.
Despite his business failures, Conway never filed for bankruptcy. And even though it caused him severe personal hardship, he paid back every investor in full.
You will not find a person in this town that will ever, ever, ever even whisper that Conway Twitty was a dishonest person. The one thing you've got in show business, in the industry, that is worth more than gold is your integrity. And he had integrity. He had honesty and integrity. The kind of stuff you can't buy. You know, that's important.
But the tourism business was Conway's biggest gamble of all.
We had a little sign in our front yard, and it said Twittyville, population 5. And we always talked about that one day we would all love to build some kind of complex that we would all live with our own individual families. So it was a dream years and years ago. And when we were moving to Nashville, we wanted to try to make this dream become a reality, and also making it possible to open up for the tourists, because Daddy felt very close to his fans.
He'd go out there and greet them on the ground. He realized there was a need there and a want for the people to see some famous, you know, country music recording star, and he filled that need. I'll tell you one thing that was really cool was Christmas at Twitty City. Conway, again, saw that need and made this incredible display that would go up every year and benefit, you know, the kids and the orphans and the wives of the firefighters and the policemen that had died. It was a very cool thing.
A year after Conway's death, Twitty City was sold and closed. But during his lifetime, it was a great testament to Conway's love for his fans.
The Life and Times of Conway Twitty returns in a moment here on TNN.
George Strait has worn Wrangler cowboy cut jeans for 30 years. To Buster here, that's 210 years. Wrangler, the Western original.
Yes or no?
That was George Strait. Now, by request, here's Bernie Brewski with the Pickle Barrel Polka.
You know your taste in music. We know your taste in jeans.
So, what do you need when it's hours since lunch and years until dinner, but you really want something and your stomach is saying, have one of these, while your brain is saying, don't even think about it and, oh, that's attractive, but this might be perfectly awful to eat because you crave something different than the usual stuff that might make you feel great and not icky, that's wild and alive and zesty and zingy and quite frankly perfect, the ache.
With a full serving of vegetables, it might just make you feel better.
Pine Sol Helpline.
I love the smell of Pine Sol, but my husband likes lemon.
Try Lemon Fresh Pine Sol Cleaner. It has the scent of lemon and the power of Pine Sol.
He'll love that. Now, if he only liked Mother.
Oh, honey, that's a whole nother helpline.
Is this for me?
Let's give that back to Santa.
That's so fast.
New Long John Silver's country-style popcorn shrimp with fries, just $1.99.
Okay, kid.
One more thing. On Dasher, on
just hit it.
Nobody does it like you.
For high traffic areas, now there's the deep cleaning power of the new Hoover Steam Vac Deluxe with 5-brush agitator.
Nobody does it like you.
Heinz calls their turkey gravy home style. But who makes gravy at home starting with water and cornstarch? Pepperidge Farm starts with natural stocks, flour, and turkey meat. It's made like homemade to taste like homemade.
The life and times of Conway Twitty continues on TNN.
You want a man with a slow hand. You want a lover with an easy hand. You want somebody who will spend some time, not come and go in a heat.
By the mid-80s, Conway had parted ways with Owen Bradley and had started to explore the boundaries between country and pop music in his own distinctive style.
He liked sexy songs, you know. And I loved Conway, but I didn't love every song he did, you know. Some of them made even me blush, you know.
But he continued to wow his fans, particularly the ladies.
I mean, it just seemed to come natural to him because he never really talked a lot to the audience or whatever. But he'd stand there and get that head down and sing, and that girl's like, ah, you know. And I had to follow him. Old fat me, you know.
Baby, believe me, I understand. When it comes to love, you want a slow hand. You want a lover with an easy touch. You want somebody who will spend some time with you, baby. Not come and go in the heated rush.
He always really thought about the housewives, the ladies. You know, he wrote songs pretty much for them to enjoy, whether it was sad or happy or sexy or whatever it was. He sang to the ladies, wrote for them, and performed for them. And the guys liked him also because he was a talented, good person.
In 1977, a woman by the name of Dee Henry was hired to work in Conway's office. After his divorce from Mickey, Conway and Dee began to date. They gradually fell in love and married in 1987.
You couldn't not love him. He told me one time, he said, I love you so many ways, so many different ways that you'll have to like one of them. And I think that was true. I liked them all.
Family and friends noticed a real change in Conway after he got together with Dee.
I never seen him be more at ease and more happy and with himself and other people around him, with his business, his personal life, everything than he was when he was with my stepmother, Dee.
He never had an enjoyable side to his life until Dee. He never did. He just worked all the time. But he told me, he said, Dee makes me happy, and anything I can do to make her happy, I'm going to do it.
He found love. He found true love. He found somebody who was a real soulmate. Dee was not just wife. They were together all the time. She traveled with him. She was in the studio with him. She was in the business with him. I mean, every part of their beings were intertwined in a real profound and special way.
Off stage, Conway and Dee shied away from the limelight.
We didn't do parties. We're not politically motivated. About the only party I can ever remember us doing, we went to Vince Gill's first number one party. And then Conway
was able to participate in a Vince Gill basketball game one year, a charity event, and they asked him to help present Vince with his first gold album, which was a real special thing, since Vince had been working with us as a background singer on some of our albums. But no, we weren't glamorous at all. I mean, what you see is what you got, and that was just two real normal people.
Conway had the love of his wife, his family, his friends, his fans. But during his long career, he was snubbed by the Country Music Association. He and Loretta were selected as Duo of the Year four times. But while Conway had more hits than anyone, he never received any individual honors for songwriting or performing. Though repeatedly nominated for Entertainer of the Year, he was always shut out.
He'd say, I'm the Susan Lucci of country music, but that's okay, because people like me. And the applause from the crowd when I walk on stage and that standing ovation that I get night after night, those are my awards. And he truly meant that. It never bothered him. It bothered the rest of us, but it never bothered him.
The Life and Times of Conway Twitty returns in a moment on TNN.
I love Christmas time. The trees and lights, warm smiles, the music. Now you can bring that feeling home with a Sitco Country Christmas cassette. Country stars like Alan Jackson, Lori Morgan, Alabama, and Randy Travis. 10 Christmas classics by 10 great country artists for only $2.49 with an 8-gallon fill-up. It's a Sitco Country Christmas. You can feel it in the air. Happy holidays from Sitco.
Hi, I'm Bill Gaither, and recently 150 of gospel music's living legends gathered around the piano with Glory and me for a joyous old-time gospel music celebration. It's a revival, and everyone sang their hearts out. You'll see old friends like Howard and Vestal Goodman, Glenn and George and Jake, and meet some new ones, too. Experience the joy when the entire homecoming family breaks into hand-clapping, toe-tapping song. Deliverance has come. The power of the sun will rise up. On home video, you'll share the gospel spirit and the good times of revival over and over again. Enjoy over an hour and a half of powerful, inspiring, deeply moving gospel music. Revival is truly a once-in-a-lifetime experience. It's gospel music at its finest, to treasure forever. Share the priceless heritage of love, faith, and hope with your family and friends today. When you order Revival now, you'll get a bonus audio cassette absolutely free. It's a wonderful value and our gift to you. Use your Visa or MasterCard and call 1-800-568-1444 now. Revival is a great gift, too, for mom or dad or for birthdays or anniversaries or just any day. Just dial 1-800-568-1444 today.
The Life and Times of Conway Twitty continues on TNN.
Since his teen idol days, Conway rarely engaged in banter with his audience or granted interviews to the media. But during the late 80s, Conway ended his long silence.
He was so careful about his image. He didn't want to violate people's ideas of who he was. He wanted to keep it kind of mysterious and a little special, particularly through the first 20 years or so. Later in life, he kind of got a little bit more relaxed about it.
Ending his silence was typical Conway. He always knew when it was time to change.
If you look back down through the years, I mean, here's a man that had number one records in five different decades, in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s. And you think about how music has changed from the 50s to the 90s. And for him to have number one records in every one of those different decades, He definitely knew how to change. He just rolled with the flow. When the sound changed, the business changed, he just changed right along with it.
It's a rainy night in Georgia. A rainy night in Georgia.
Always looking for a new challenge, Conway agreed to perform a duet with Sam Moore for the Rhythm, Country, and Blues Project. Sam, part of the legendary Sam and Dave duo, met Conway for the first time in the studio the day they recorded.
He just gave me this smile, and he gave me, and I mean, hey, man, we walked right in, and we started talking, and we talked so much until they had to call us a couple of times. Come on, you know, this is business here. You know, we got to do this. A rainy night in Georgia. With us, it was a lot of love and a lot of fun. And that's the way it came off. And that was, you may say, they were faking it. It was no fake. That was real. And I always appreciate that he let me do what I do best. Man, was he great.
Conway!
The recording session took place on May 3rd, 1993. It would be Conway's last.
I've been very fortunate for 35 years. People haven't gotten tired of Conway Twitty yet, and I'm glad, because I'm sure not tired of singing yet.
I know. Oh, God.
This was one of Conway's final interviews. He was up, both professionally and personally. He never had drank. He had quit smoking, and with Dee's encouragement, had begun to exercise regularly and eat right. But on June 4th, 1993, Conway was returning to Nashville after having performed in Branson, Missouri. Earlier, he had complained of feeling a pressure in his side.
I suggested stopping at an emergency room, and he said, no, that's not necessary. If, you know, it's not that bad. And I said, well, if you're no better tomorrow, we're going to go see Dr. Van Davender. And he said, yeah, well, you know how I am. And he was somebody who took very good care of himself. He said, you know how I am. If it's not better tomorrow, we'll go see him. And then it just happened.
Conway collapsed on his tour bus from a ruptured abdominal aneurysm. He died the next day at a hospital in Springfield, Missouri. Conway Twitty was 59 years old.
He was kind of the consummate country entertainer. He looked like a country entertainer, and he never lost that youthful feel that he had for the music.
He was one of my greatest friends. We worked together. We had a business together. We sang together. We never had a fight. Never. Nothing that we couldn't talk about.
He always went out of his way to try to be a friend, to try to help somebody, you know. And I think that's the main thing he'd want people to remember, loving his music, loving what he did for a living, you know, because he definitely loved to do it.
He was very involved in all of our lives, and I believe we're guided by him daily. So he's with each one of us.
He was honest to himself, kind, loving individual who cared about other people, did things above and beyond the call of friendship at times, and he'd want people to recognize that, and that he loved his fans and his friends and his family.
Conway once said, you have to remember, you're not singing for yourself. You're singing for the fans. Otherwise, I might as well sit home and sing to myself. And they'll remember the music long after I'm gone. Well, Conway, I think you only got it half right. Because it's hard to imagine that you'll ever be forgotten.
Jimmy, you remember that?
Boy, oh boy, I'm ready for this.
Mrs. Smith's pies, the taste that takes you home. Now Mrs. Smith's pumpkin pies are 40% larger.
How important is freshness in a dry cat food?
Is there a way to be sure my cat's food is fresh?
Purina Cat Chow has this freshness seal right on the front of every bag. It's your guarantee Cat Chow is consistently fresh every time you buy it, every time you serve it.
Taking better care of my cat makes us both feel better.
Purina Cat Chow brands. Better care makes better cats.
Oh, what do you need when it's hours since lunch and years until dinner, but you really want something and your stomach is saying, have one of these, while your brain is saying, don't even think about it, and oh, that's attractive. But this might be perfectly awful to eat because you crave something different than the usual stuff that might make you feel great and not icky, that's wild and alive and zesty and zingy and quite frankly perfect. The Eight.
With a full serving of vegetables, it might just make you feel better.
It's a December to remember on TNN. Monday the 4th, there's Magic in the Music, Christmas with Vince Gill. Wednesday the 6th, join Gary Chapman, Amy Grant, and Alison Krauss in celebrating the spirit of the season, a Sam's Place Christmas special. Tuesday the 12th, go home for the holidays with Supergroup Alabama, Christmas in Dixie. It's a December to remember on TNN, the Nashville Network.